Welcome to my talk, Deep Learning, Theory and Practice. I hope that the title is already a little bit of a giveaway of what I'm going to talk about. So it can't be a surprise that I'm going to talk about the theory behind deep learning, but also how we put this in practice at our company. And I will also show some examples of what I think are cool deep learning research projects at other companies. So my name is Remco Runge. I'm a software engineer at Ordina in the Netherlands, and I mainly focus at AI. So I have a background in AI, so I really like everything that has to do with AI. So I would like to start with a little video clip. This video clip is of a humanoid robot, Ashimo, which was developed by Honda. This robot can climb stairs. But not so well. This video clip was from 2006, not even that long ago. It's only 13 years ago. For me, that was the last year of high school. But if you look at that robot, it seems quite, for me, quite old. It could also have been a movie clip from the 90s, maybe also due to the video quality, apparently not full HD. But if we skip to 2019, we have now a company which is called Boston Dynamics, and I think that most of you might know the robots they built, but I still want to show one video. This is Atlas. Atlas is a humanoid robot. Well, you could say that we have come a long way since 2006. I mean, I don't see Ashimo do this kind of jumps. So this development happened, of course, because we have better, more computational power, because we have better sensors, we have more research money, but also thanks to the field of deep learning. Deep learning made it possible for these robots to learn. So what I want to do, I want to tell you something about the theory behind deep learning. And I want to start by telling you something about how we used to do computer vision. What we used to do, if you want to know whether or not something is a rabbit or if it's a dog, we would look at the features of that animal. And we would try to describe the features. And we would say, well, if I look at a rabbit, compared to a dog, it has really short paws. It has a very small body. While a dog has a really big body, has long paws, and has the eyes on the front of the face, while the rabbit has the eyes on the side of the face. And we would try to develop algorithms. And the algorithms should be able to capture these features. And combining these algorithms, we would try to recognize a rabbit or recognize a dog. And this works, more or less. If you go onto the Google and you look up images of rabbits and dogs, what you will see is that, well, there are also dogs with short bodies, with short legs, which are more similar to rabbits than we originally thought. So this doesn't completely work as intended. So we draw inspiration from how our brain works. So our brain is really good at recognizing dogs or rabbits. And this happens because if we see a rabbit, we will see the rabbit, the stimuli will go into our eye, into our brain, and all kinds of neurons start firing. And in the end, we know, well, we saw a rabbit. Deep learning tries to mimic this. And therefore, we are using something which are called artificial neural networks. And artificial neural networks are, some of you might already know them, are like a model of how our brain works, but only inspired by our brain. It isn't a perfect replica, of course, but still. So what happens in such a network, an image will go into the network, and at the end, we will have an output. We will say whether or not it's a rabbit or a dog, for example. So how does an image go into the network? Well, the great thing is that an image is just, in a computer, mostly three layers, red, green, and blue. And each pixel has a certain value. So we can just input these values into our network, because these are just numbers. So these go into the input layer of the network. They flow into the network, and you have to. So the image I have over here has only three input nodes, but imagine that for every pixel, for every color channel, you need an input node. So this is a very oversimplification of the real network. So if we zoom into the network and we zoom into such a node, we model this node by having the inputs on the left, the neuron or the node in the middle, and the output on the right. And what happens in such a node is quite simple. It just summarizes the inputs. Okay, but we want the node also to learn, the network to learn. Thus, there can be certain inputs that are more important than other inputs in deciding whether or not there's a rabbit or a dog on the image. For example, the pixels that represent the eyes are more important to recognize whether or not it's a rabbit or a dog. So we put weights on these inputs. And then we can just calculate in a quite simple way. Folks, let's say that we have the weights 1, 4, and 2. And we have the inputs 5, 2, and 3. If you want to know the output, what we do is we multiply. We multiply 5 times 1, 2 times 4, and 3 times 2. And we summarize it. And this gives us the output of the network, 19. And this flows to the other nodes. So there's one more thing. I don't want to go into too deep, but there's also an activation function. And the activation function mainly is there because it makes the output non-linear. This is a mathematical thing. If the output would have been linear, what you could do is compress the whole network into one node, which does thousands of inputs and a couple of outputs. You wouldn't get a network, you would just get one node. So just believe me, you need an activation function. So if we look at the whole network again, you can see we have a couple of layers. We have the input layer, so where the image flows into the network. We have the hidden layer, and this can be one or more hidden layers. And we have the output layer. So the output layer tells us whether or not there's a rabbit or a dog on the image. But the hidden layers, that is where the magic happens. Here are all kinds of nodes connected with each other, with all kinds of weights. And by adapting these weights, the network can learn. So how does the network learn? Well, we use something which is called supervised learning. For some of you, this might be familiar if you went to another talk today, also about machine learning. Let's assume we have a data set with a rabbit and with dogs, and we have a labeled data set. So we already know what's on the image. So we know that there are rabbits and dogs on the image. Then we can input such a rabbit into the network, just the pixel values. This step is called the forward propagation step. So the image is fed through the network. The network will say, well, I think it's a dog or a rabbit, but in this case, it's more confident that it's a dog. And initially, when the weights aren't trained, when the network hasn't been trained a lot, this will be quite random. So because it needs to learn, so it will just guess. But we know what's on the image, so we know if the network is correct or when it's wrong. So we can tell the network, well, you were wrong. Try to do it better back next time. And this is called the backward propagation step. So now it flows back through the network, and it tells the network to shift all the weights in such a way that next time you will probably give the right answer. And if you do this thousands of times, hundreds of thousands of times, the network will learn to recognize rabbits and dogs. This is quite a simple network. These networks were already around in the 90s. Even before deep learning. These have one big problem. Oh, sorry. So it learns the rabbit. It has one big problem. It really learns an average representation of the image. So the average representation of the dog. Or to make it a bit more clear, these are the outputs of a network, of the weights of a network, which was trained to recognize cars. And you might be able to see that there are like the wheels over here, and there's the body of the car. I'm not sure if it's really clear. But this is it's like a template of a car. So if you have an image of a car which fits that template, the network will be able to say, well, I see a car. But it becomes more difficult when the car is scaled because it doesn't fit the template anymore. or if the car's at the other place on the image, it won't fit. Or even if the car, if the image is taken from a different angle. So this is why these networks didn't really work that well in the 90s. But nowadays, we have deep learning, and one of the networks we have within deep learning are convolutional neural networks. And what convolutional neural networks do, they don't look at the whole image at once, they try to learn different features of the image. So at a low level, the networks will learn like diagonal lines, horizontal lines, and they will try to combine these into mid-level features, and in the end, to more high-level features. And if we zoom in onto such high-level features, what was learned by network recognizing cars, what we can see here is that this more or less represents the grille of a car. Maybe some imagination, but it learns specific parts of the car. And you can imagine that if the car changes in angle or in size, it still can recognize these features. Okay, bit more theory. A convolutional neural network, let's assume we have the letter X in a 9x9 pixel array. Again, you can see that it has some features which distinguish whether or not it's an X. So they're like the diagonal lines or the middle part. And if you would put into such a network images which are where the X is on a different place in the image, or where the X is rotated, you would still be able to recognize these part of the images. So by learning these features, you can still recognize X's even if they are rotated. So a convolutional network does this by trying to learn filters, so only small parts of small features of an image. And what it does with these filters, if it learns these filters, it will try to apply these filters over the whole image. So it will just step over the image and will apply and will see where does this filter match with the image. And if you do this for the whole image, so let's assume you go over the whole image, what you then will see is that you get a feature map. And this image shows where the filter matched with the image. So you can see a diagonal line. So you have a filter which is really sensitive for diagonal lines. And you can do this for multiple filters, so the network will just try to learn filters. So in this case, I assume that the network has learned a diagonal filter, but we do not know, because we do not tell the network what kinds of filters it needs to learn. But for example, it could also learn the diagonal line the other side. So and this helps with recognizing, in this case, letter X, because the features of the letter X are diagonal lines. So it does not try to create a template of the letter X, but just look at the features. So just a little bit more about the activation function. In this case, we could choose the ReLU activation function, and this does only one thing. It makes it nonlinear, and it does that by everything that is negative will become zero, and everything that is positive will stay positive. So not that difficult, but this is used a lot. If you apply that, the feature map doesn't change that much, but it's quite important. And then what we do is a pooling step. And pooling step is like subsampling of the image. And this helps the network to be less sensitive to the different scales of the image, or the different places on the image where the letter X can be. And what this does, it again goes over the image. But we don't have a filter this time. What we do is quite simple. We just take the maximum of these four squares. And we put this in a new matrix. And we step over to the next part. And in this case, we have a stride of two. So it will step with steps of two over the image. And you can imagine if your strides are bigger, you will get a smaller matrix on the right. So if we do this for the whole image, again, you can see that we still have that diagonal line. So it's still sensitive for diagonal line. But if we would have as an input an image of the letter X, which was shifted a little bit upwards, it would still have the same diagonal line. So it becomes less sensitive. So basically, a convolutional neural network has an input, has a convolutional layer, a pooling layer, and gives you a feature map. but this isn't our answer because we still do not know whether or not it's a rabbit or a dog. So what we do, those feature maps, and these can be multiple feature maps, we'll just feed it in the same network we saw in the beginning, a fully connected network. And now we can have as an output, the, for example, letter X or O. So does anyone of you know Java, the language? None of you? Okay, so just one. Okay, for you, I'm going to show you how you can do this in Java. So please bear with me. So I'm using a framework which is called Deep Learning for Java. And what I'm going to try to train the network is on handwritten digits. Why I'm doing this in Java and not in Python? Because I can. It's not really a reason to do this in Java, but you can do it in Java. So what we have over here is I also, of course, have some boilerplate encode around it. But what we have here is just configuration of the network. So what you can see is we built a neural net configuration. So it says font size big enough, by the way. Yeah. Okay. We have an updater, in this case a Nesterov. This is how the weights are updated. Just believe me, Nesterov is okay. And we set the input type. These images will be 28 by 28 pixels and only one color channel because they are black and white. And we built a network. So what we want to do, and I'm a bit of a slow typer, so I'm going to use some templating. We're going to add a layer, a confluential layer. And we can say, well, we want it to have the filter size, that little box has to be 3 by 3. We can say, well, we want, in this case, 20 output layers or feature maps. As an activation function, we'll use ReLU, and we build this layer. But this wasn't the whole story. We also needed another layer. We needed a pooling layer. So I can also add a pooling layer. And you can see it's like a subsampling layer. It's also called a subsampling layer. And we use the maximum value. The kernel size is 2 by 2, so the box. The stride, in this case, is 2 by 2. So it will step in steps of 2. And we build this layer. Now, the last layer we need, an output layer. So it has a loss function. So the loss function helps determine how bad or how well the network is performing and how it should shift its weights. Well, we have like 10 numbers. So the number of output nodes should be 10. It should always be equal to the classes you are trying to get as output. In this case, we use the softmax activation function. And that's the only reason to use the softmax is because it will give nice numbers between 0 and 1. So that makes it really easy to compare the outputs. And we built this. So this seems like a nice little convolutional network. And we can run this. Of course, I'm hoping that I didn't make any mistakes. So it will now try to start train this network. So it will go like 250 iterations through the data set. And it will print some statistics about how well it's performing. So what it's printing right now, let's see if I have my PowerPoint somewhere. What it's printing is the confusion matrix. And confusion matrix gives some idea about how well the network performs. Because on the right side of the confusion matrix are the classes that we know that are on the image. And on the top bar are the classes that the image is the network is predicting. So for example, this is the confusion matrix of like the first iteration, so we saw just a couple of examples. We can see that in 37 of the cases it will correctly predict the number 0. It will say, well, it is number 0, and in fact it is number 0. But at the same time, in 497 cases, it will say, well, it's a number 5. Well, in fact, it is the number 0. So the total accuracy in this case is almost 70%. So if you do this for a couple of iterations, in this case, I think that I looped through the whole dataset 250 times, you will get a different confusion matrix, and now you can see a nice diagonal line. That means that in this case, we have 992 correctly predicted number 0. And we never say that the number 0 is a number 5. So let's see how it's going in the console. So it's still working. Maybe due to that it being on the battery, it's a little bit slower. So normally this takes about well, 1-2 minutes. So we'll just have to wait until it finishes. Because I wanted to also show you that this really works, that it will really be able to recognize some stuff. So we can already see over here that it has now an accuracy of 0.95. Okay, it finished. So I'll just go out of the presentation mode for a second and start a little Spring Boot application. So that one is starting. So let's see if it's already up. No. Okay, now it is. So I have a nice little canvas over here. So the model is already loaded into the application. That only took like 5 seconds. And I can now draw a number. And I can just pray and hope that it will be able to classify this number. Let's see. Okay. This is the top three of numbers that it is predicting. And it says, well, I think that's number 2 with a confidence of 0.72. Let's give it a really hard one. Yeah, so it fails. So this network isn't perfect. This has to do a little bit with that my front end isn't perfect in compressing the images to the same format as we're using to train the network. But also because the training data is not perfect. So if you look at this data set, what you will see is that there's also some numbers inside that even I'm not able to recognize. So I'm not completely sure how we can expect the neural network to learn that, yeah, I don't know what this is, but that we can recognize these numbers. And of course, the network I trained was a really small network just to be really fast, so I could show you what it does. But in fact, it's an oversimplification. And if you want to know how to create the best network, it's just trial and error. You'll just try, add more layers, change the parameters, and see how it's going to perform. So I want to show you one thing we did at Ordina, which I presented at Devoxx. It was a hands-on workshop. And in this case, we wanted people to also try to train a neural network. Does anyone of you know this guy? We didn't have lots of Java developers, so probably not. This is the mascot of Java. Yeah, Java needs a mascot. So we created a program, or we created a workshop in which you can learn how to recognize the Duke. In order to do so, what we did was we created a data set of images of the Duke. And also negative images, in this case just faces, background, stuff like that. Because we want the network to learn, well, there's a Duke or there's no Duke. There's something else on the image. But if you want to do this, this is a way more difficult example compared to just recognizing numbers in 9x9 pixels. Because you can imagine that the input format is way bigger. You have 3 color channels, there are a lot of different features. So if you want to do this, it takes quite a lot of training time. And we didn't have that training time, because at the end of the day, I want to go home and I don't want to keep training. So we use a technique which is called transfer learning. And transfer learning uses what we previously saw. So we have the convolutional network which learns all kinds of features, and we have the classification layer. And basically, if we train a convolutional neural network, the features it learns might also be applicable into recognizing Dukes, because there are also horizontal lines on this Duke, vertical lines, stuff like that. So what we can do is just say, well, we only train this part. We throw away everything it has learned in this section, but we'll keep everything he has learned for the features. And this means that we can train a network in like 5 minutes. So this is way quicker. So I also want to show you not the training of the network, but the recognition of this network. So let me just kill this one. So this one takes a little bit more time to load, because in this case we have a network which was originally trained for 1,000 different objects. And we said, well, try to classify two kinds of objects, juke or no juke, with it. So in reality, the network is quite big for its goal. So you can see over here that it's loading. So again, just a simple Spring Boot application which loads in the network. So let's get to the interface. So, great, I'm not a juke. Let's see if this works. Oh, never do a live demo. You can see it detects the juke. So it's able to recognize this juke just by training the network for like 5 minutes. And we trained it on about 60 images of jukes and 60 images of not jukes. So the data set is really, really small. And again, this can be done thanks for us by using transfer learning. So this works. So this is, of course, all fun, but we also created applications that are really used by customers. One of these applications, for this application, the goal was to recognize and localize signs along the rail tracks. So this problem is a little bit more difficult than the problem of the juke, because if I show the juke in front of the camera, it will only know there is a juke somewhere on that image, but it has no clue where on the image the juke is. So what we did, we trained a digital rail survey network. We trained a network which was able to say, well, there is the speed sign, there is a speed sign on the image, and it is over there. In order to be able to both recognize the speed sign and also know where on the image the speed sign is, we use a technique, or a network, which is called YOLO. And YOLO stands for you only look once. So the network only looks once at the image. Yeah, you will. So what it does, it has as an input, of course, an image. And then it does two things simultaneously. It will try to find on the image where there are bounding boxes, where there are objects. And at the same time, it also tries to determine where on the image there are certain classes of objects. So it will divide the whole image in squares and will say, well, in this square, I think there is a... I have no clue what the tiles of the floor. And by combining these two, you can say, well, I see a dog and the dog is over there. So this is way more powerful. So I can also show you this really works in a video. And this has quite a long intro, so I'm going to skip a little bit ahead. So we see here a snelheidsbord, a speed sign, which is recognized. And this can be used to know, for example, if the speed signs are on the place that was decided by the railways that they should be. This isn't always the case. Sometimes signs get moved or they forget to remove a sign and the maps don't match the real world. So you saw that it could keep track of the sign for quite long. So I have a different video clip for a different sign. Again, this is just an image taken from the train. And you will see it's able to recognize the sign and also know where on the image the sign is. And this is all thanks to YOLO. So we had another assignment, and this was to try to recognize GV plates and also localize them and also to read GV plates. And GV plates are signs on the side of trains which tell you what kind of dangerous stuff is inside of the train. So again, quite useful to know what kind of stuff is in trains. So if you could detect what kind of stuff is inside the train just by placing a camera on the side of the railways. The beautiful thing about GV plates is they aren't all completely similar. They can have different shades of orange, they can have different font types, the layout can be a little bit different. But this is really not a real problem for deep learning, because it is able to be a little bit less sensitive to all these kinds of things. And if you look at the real plates on trains, you can see that the images are quite hard to read. So quite a difficult task. So in this case, a network was built which was able to recognize the GV plates, localize them, and a different network was built to read the GV plates, because these are really two different assignments, localizing them and reading them. But there was one problem. We didn't have enough data. Because if you take a video stream off the side of a train, most of the time the train will have quite the same cargo. So all the GV plates are the same GV plates for the whole train or for big parts of the train. What you then can do is use data generation. You can simply try to generate images of GV plates, place them on a background which is more or less similar to what you can see in the real life. And if you do this often enough, in this case 100,000 times, you will still be able to detect GV plates, because the results were quite good. With an accuracy of 93%, we were able to recognize the GV plates on the train. So both where the GV plate is, but also what is on the GV plate. So I also have a little video clip, of course, of how this works. So for me, it's quite hard to see where the GV plate is, but the blue box helps. So believe me, over there, there's a GV plate. So I also want to show something about what else you can do with deep learning. This image, of course, not painted by the famous painter Van Gogh. I guess the TVH Training Center. If you would like to create such an image, you can do it yourself at deepart.io, because these images are trained by a technique which is called style transfer. And what style transfer does, it uses a neural network to determine the style on one image and combine it with the content on another image. And this is again based on these features that we learned, because you can imagine that if you look at low-level features, they might describe more about style, while high-level features describe more about the content of the image. So by combining these, you get these beautiful images. You can also apply this to horses. So if you would like to have a zebra, you can use style transfer to create your own zebra. So I want to do a little quiz with you. I have two images. Two women over here, and I'm just curious, one of these images is fake. If you are able to detect which image is fake, so who of you thinks that the first image is fake? Some of you, yeah, okay. And who of you thinks that the second image is fake? Yeah, you're pretty good at it, because the second image is fake. How do we know it's fake? Well, we can see it a little bit in the eyes. She's a little bit cockeyed. Well, of course, it happens to real people also, but if faces are generated, it's a little bit, you will see it more often. The shading of the eyes is also a little bit different for each eye. Again, this can happen in real people, but it's quite rare. But you can also see, for example, the earring is quite fake. So this happens when these images are generated, there are still some artifacts inside. But still, it's quite a good face to be just be generated, so she doesn't really exist. So for the people who didn't notice this wasn't a real face, don't worry, because it was used in a spying operation, and it was used to trick politicians in Washington, D.C. to befriend her on LinkedIn, to make a connection with her. So she tried to make connections with high-powered politician people just using a fake face. And people accepted her, so it worked. So how does such a network work? Well, in order to create these fake images, basically you use two different networks. One network is able to discriminate between real images and fake images, and the other network is a generator and tries to generate real-looking faces. So the generator just gets noise as input and tries to create a face, while the discriminator also was trained on real images. And what you do is you let them battle. You just say, keep generating fake faces, discriminator be the judge, say, well, you're wrong, you're correct, it's a good face, I'm tricked, or it's a fake face. And if you do this often enough, you can create real-looking faces. You can also combine style transfer and generating faces, just to generate the adversarial networks, so adversarial because they have to battle. And what you can see over here is that the top images are like the image of the TFAH building. So that's where the style will be transposed onto. Maybe I forgot it all the way around. But you can see that all these images are fake. So the background stays quite the same. So the skin color stays quite the same as the image on the left, but the age goes with the age on the top. For me, it's quite hard to understand that these are fake images. So be aware who befriends you on LinkedIn, just saying. NVIDIA used this technique to create a nice little drawing tool. So on the left, you have like a sort of paint. And you can use it to create beautiful landscapes on the right. Again, by generating images. So for this video, I would have loved to have sound. And that's a little bit of a problem. I don't have sound, I guess. I think that I only have it on my laptop. So I won't try to do an impression, but I will try to tell you what they are saying. And I think that most of you know this video clip, maybe. So it's from the show called CSI. It's only on. So they are talking about magnifying the image, because there's some killer. And if you magnify the reflection in the eye, and you try to enhance it a little bit more and more and more and more, you will in the end be able to see that the person is wearing a baseball or something like that. I think that all of you thought the same thing when you saw this originally or when you see it now. Well, this can never happen. I mean, if you look at an image and it's really pixelated, we won't be able to tell you what it should have been because it are just big pixels. There's no information there. Google did a little research and it used as an input these images, really pixelated faces. And they trained the network to try to create real faces from these images. And this is what it came up with. Looks pretty real already. And if you compare it with what it should have been, which was the ground truth, I think that you might have been able to recognize, for example, this person by looking at this image. So CSI wasn't that much of a fiction. It was real science. So I think that most of you also know that China is investing a lot of money into AI. And it invests a lot of money into AI to track its people. For some cities, I think that the city with the most cameras per person has like one camera for every six persons in that city. So you only have to share your camera with six other persons. I have a little movie clip to show you what those cameras can do. At least it should start. Just do it this way. So this camera can track, just from one standpoint, can track the movement of people, make a 3D map of it. It can also detect like hundreds of people at the same time on a big square and keep track of where they walk. So they don't get mixed. It will identify unique persons. It's able to detect faces at a really high speed. So you can imagine that if such a camera is at your street, it will always know where you are and can always track you. Even if you go out of the frame and back into the frame, it still will is still able to follow your movement. Luckily, there are techniques which you can use to circumvent this. Research has shown that if you wear a t-shirt with a certain pattern, what you can do is you can try to make the camera think that you are something, or make the deep learning network think that you are something else than a person, or not a person at all. So in this case, the network isn't able to see that you are a person. It's able to see the person next to it, but thanks to this great pattern, it thinks you're something else. You can't never be a person. But you can also use different techniques. For example, you could use like a beamer on your face to present a different face. This should also be able to circumvent these systems. So if you go to China, might be a good investment. But trying to circumvent the deep learning networks can also be a little bit more dangerous. A different research has shown that if you put some stickers at the right place on a stop sign, what will happen is that the deep learning network will recognize the stop sign as a speed sign, a speed limit 45. So if you are driving in your fancy Tesla and it's recognizing, well, I can go 45 here at this nice little stopping place, you can imagine what can happen. And personally, I wouldn't think twice if I see such a stickers on my stop sign. I would think, well, some kids put some stickers over there. But it can have real consequences. And this is something that is not always taken into account when developing all kinds of deep learning networks. Other research has shown that by placing certain stickers on the roadside, you can mimic the line which the Tesla tries to follow. So you could make a turn where the Tesla shouldn't turn. Just something to keep in mind. So I had some other video clips which I would have loved to show, but since I don't have audio, I'm just going to skip this one. Yeah, it's about Obama, so sorry about that. So no Java developers, I know that, but maybe some other developers here in the room that know this book or should have known this book. I'm a great fan of it, copying and pasting from Stack Overflow, because that's basically what we as developers do. More or less. So how great would it be if we do not have to copy and paste from Stack Overflow? If we can just integrate this into our IDE? So that would mean we have more free time, more time to compile. Microsoft is working on such a technique, on a plugin. This is trained on data from GitHub, which Microsoft now owns. So that might also be the reason why Microsoft has bought GitHub. And it's trained on all kinds of different repositories. And it helps by suggesting what kind of code you need to type. So this should make our work a little bit easier. So it should improve the already code suggestions that our IDEs have. So I'm not sure if this is really something useful in this image, but it should show how useful it is. Again, something I would have loved to show you with sound. So I'm going to skip that, and I think that there's also... Okay, there's no sound here, but let's try. So Google... I'm going to go the wrong way. Google has the Google Assistant, and you probably all have it on your phone. They launched a system, and I think that's already live in America, in which the Google Assistant also can make phone calls for you and make appointments for you. So this movie clip shows you how how that system makes such an appointment. I'm not completely sure if it's going to be useful if it's with no audio, but let's try. So it's calling a restaurant, and it's discussing. So this conversation didn't completely went as planned. So on the other side of the line, the restaurant was a nice Chinese woman with a quite heavy accent, which didn't completely understand the Google Assistant. But in the end, the Google Assistant was still able to understand what she meant and to create an appointment for you. The Google Assistant does this by using a couple of different deep learning networks, because it has to understand speech, it has to make decisions based on what it understands, so it has to know when it can plan your reservation, but it also has to create speech back, it has to synthesize speech. So this is quite amazing, and I expect that this will become available in the Netherlands in the quite near future. So this is something really powerful that deep learning can do for you. So during this talk, I have tried to give you some theoretical background about deep learning. I have tried to show you how you can put this in practice, and of course showed you some cool stuff. I'm sorry about the videos that didn't have sound. It's also why I have still some time left. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. So are there any questions? If not, I would really like to thank you for your attention. Oh, one question, yeah.
You said you're from Holland, so yeah. Are there different speeds in AI development between
Belgium and Holland? To be quite honest, so you say speech, or did you say speed?
Speed.
Speed. I don't know. I don't know what the situation in Belgium is. So, of course, in Holland, we are way ahead. No, so of course in Holland it's also just emerging technology, and more companies are investing in AI, and currently I'm working on a project which really uses deep learning for computer vision. Unfortunately, the NDA forbids me from talking about it, but yeah, so there is a big push for AI, but I would hope that the push is the same in Belgium. So thank you for your attention.